Hello and welcome to NewsClick, this program with real news. We have with us Seema Mustafa, eminent journalist, and we'll be discussing the issues in Kashmir. Kashmir has been on the boil for some time. It doesn't seem to be quietening down. And we have senior army officials, including the general himself, the chief commander-in-chief, who's been talking about how this cannot be handled by the military, or it cannot be handled by the through force alone. Seema, do you think this army coming out and saying that this cannot be handled by army and it cannot be handled by the use of force, we need to talk, has made a change in the Kashmir scenario?
It would make a change in the Kashmir scenario if the government was listening and moved and took these remarks as serious caution and moved to bring in peace. There was a debate as soon as General Hooda spoke, whether he had the sanction of the government, didn't have it. The point is that the Indian Army in Kashmir has been making these statements for a long time. I remember the 1990s when you had the terrorism, insurgent militancy cycle, the decade of militancy. The army then also would say that we go into areas, we cleanse them, or whatever words they use, of the militants and insurgents, and they've always wanted to pull out and ask the civilian government to go in with reconciliation, with, you know, other measures. Usually the political governments of Jammu and Kashmir are reluctant to do that, and they leave the army over there facing the flak. And especially in areas where there have been encounters and military confrontations with the civilians, then it becomes like a red rag to the bull. And the relations between the civilian population and the army really degenerates. This is something the army has never wanted to do. And it always says that we are not a soft force. So if you bring in the army, violations are inherent in that.
The army is used to fight, so
right.
They cannot handle.
We are an external force. They're not the police that they're going to go and hold your hand. You know, they're there to eliminate whatever is the enemy. It's a political decision that you put the army against your own people and say, well, that's the enemy. Whereas the army is supposed to be at the borders looking across and then dealing with the enemy. So this is a very sad situation, and you made them almost like occupying force. And then you talk of nationalism, but nationalism also means that you use your institutions the way you have trained them. Army is an institution that should be used at the border, not against its own people. And every now and again, if you go back in the records, senior generals, top commanders, GOCs in command in Jammu and Kashmir have made these kind of statements that pull us out. We don't want to be here.
You said that the government of India, the current government, does not seem to be interested in peace. We have right now the Home Minister who's gone there, who's trying to talk to various parties. Why do you think that they're not serious about peace in Kashmir?
If there has to be a dialogue, it has to be an inclusive dialogue. Anger has reached a certain level. We've been warning of this since 2010, when the first round of violence involving the young people of Kashmir took place. And this is a generation that has been born and brought up in violence. It might not have directly faced it because it was born after the militancy years, but it is now directly facing it. And anger is intense that they're being excluded, they're being left out, and they are being treated as if they are somebody else. So when you are going over there and you know that the conditions have reached another level, as you can even judge from the opposition response, you've got to reach out with extraordinary measures. You can't go in and say, well, I'm going to talk to you, but I'm not going to talk to them. Even the army commander, forget entire opposition in the Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha, National Conference, which has come with a delegation now, everybody is emphasizing that you should speak to the student leaders or the young people, to the separatists, to the political mainstream, to lawyers, to various shades of opinion, and try and work a solution. But the government is still saying no. It's got to be the people we want. That doesn't work, not in a situation like Kashmir.
Have you seen this kind of situation in a very long time? Because I think this has reached dimensions which is even beyond the 90s, where you really had a lot of violence, insurgency in Kashmir.
You know, the big difference between the 90s and today is that time they were mostly militants. Pakistan had a real direct role. You knew it. You knew that there were militants who were coming in. Some got sanctuary, some didn't get sanctuary. And the local population, when we went in later, was always found itself to be hostage by one side, the militants who had come in with their guns, and the other side, the forces that had come in with their guns. And it was the bichara Kashmiri who really got, you know, sandwiched between two opposing forces. Whether he was giving shelter or not giving shelter, he was still hit. And that is where the violations came. They came from one side and the other side. They can keep saying it's Pakistan and they can say whatever, but the Pakistan factor hasn't increased. One side we say we put an end to infiltration. One side we say we have secured our borders, which are statements that have come out all the time. Everybody knows in Jammu and Kashmir, infiltration is minimalist. And whatever the Pakistan factor was there before is still there. In fact, it's less because the young people are as alienated from Pakistan as they are, or at least as much as they might be from New Delhi. So the point is that, you know, you're actually dealing with the masses now. You're dealing with your own people. If you call them an integral part of India, then you're dealing with your own people. The leadership is being taken by young boys. And people are themselves shocked. I mean, Kashmiri civil society, all seniors, absolutely shocked. They said the young boys come into your face, look into your eyes, and literally taunt you because they're not scared of dying. There's a certain romanticization of the rebellion, as it were, or the revolution in young minds, which, you know, cannot be addressed. And then there is this anger, seething anger, when people they know are killed.
You know, it's also very interesting to see that you have Rajnath Singh trying to talk about talking to people, talking to different sections, and you have Arun Jaitley saying stone pelters are paid from by Pakistanis. Now, this is at some level absurd because you can't really be paying 12-year-olds, 13-year-olds, 14-year-olds who are on the streets today.
They started this propaganda earlier, and then it came that 500 rupees or 1,000 rupees to every stone pelter. So the immediate response was, then why don't you pay 2,000 and keep us off the streets? Simple, right? If it is all a question of money, then if they bought your guys with 500 rupees, you can buy them with 1,000 rupees and tell them to stay indoors. If it's all a money game, everybody knows this is ridiculous. And also the point is that if you're speaking in so many voices and under an umbrella of we will not, then visits like the Home Minister are doomed to fail. Because there is already an umbrella, a cloak built around that visit, which is of non-conciliation.
Do you see that post-Modi speech regarding Balochistan and Gilgit and so on, that we are seeing externally a hardening of relationship, hardening of relations, and actually this aggressive posture also would translate in trying to really use greater force in Kashmir? Do you see that is the
trajectory? I think the link is very clear. Linkages have been made by different statements through these years and even earlier by the same people, linking Pakistan and Kashmir and Kashmir and the Indian Muslim. And, you know, there is a certain narrative that is built around this. So you close all options. So, you close all options with Pakistan. You make sure that you're not going to dialogue with them. And at the same time, you harden with Kashmir. But the point is, you know, all this sounds very good. Even if you say it's the RSS ideology and they are acting according to a strategy, yes, they are. There is an ideology. But then what is the strategy? Where is this going to take you? I mean, to what point can you harden it?
Now, that's an interesting issue, because if you see what Modi started with, he started by talking about how he will really solve regional problems to dialogue and so on. And the belief was that it is, if you are quote unquote hard, aggressive on one hand and extend your hand for of friendship on the other, things will actually work out because they will see you're a strong person. But it really, that's not the way it has gone with either China or with Pakistan.
It doesn't work. It doesn't work with anyone. I mean, you try to do it with the US tomorrow, it won't work. Right now, with the US, we're only reaching out a hand of friendship and embrace and hugs and all. We're giving no riot act kind of speeches. So it's working with them. Tomorrow you turn around and you tell Washington what you think of them on certain issues, that'll be the end there also. So it's not, you know, this kind of an attitude with world governments doesn't work. But what I'm bothered about is that if you're going to harden your position to this extent, then what's your next step going to be eventually? It's going to be war. That if you're following a certain path, are you prepared to take that path to its logical conclusion, which is war with your neighbors? Then you have China also on one side because they've got interests in Gwadar and they've got interests in Balochistan.
In any case, strategic interests. Two nuclear powers, India
and
Pakistan.
Then nuclear.
Forget China. Even the two nuclear powers being at loggerheads going to war is a very, very dangerous situation.
Absolutely.
If it is not an absurd situation.
You know, because there have been so many discussions reporters have asked, journalists have also asked, you've looked at the commentary. There is, we know what you're doing today, but do you know what you're going to do tomorrow? There doesn't seem to be an answer.
Thank you very much, Seema. We'll continue to follow Kashmir because I think that's something which is going to be central to India-Pakistan relations, if not to Indian polity as well. Thank you very much. This is all we have time for NewsClick today. Keep watching NewsClick for further episodes.